Thank you. Thank you, Hanneke. I'm going to pick up where John left us this morning. Is this...
No?
So should I... Okay.
No, it's
on now. It's
on now? Yeah. I'm going to pick up where John left us this morning on Java. And notably the site TRINIL. The story is by now very well known. It was excavated by Eugène Dubois in the 1890s. And as you can see, it's a huge excavation. And one of the things that, to our surprise, turned up in the museum in Naturalis, so after a long time lounging in the cardboard boxes, was a shell that had an engraving. This was published last year, and in my talk now I'm going to tell you a little bit about the background, how it was discovered and what we did to show that it was really an old engraving made by Homo erectus, and also what that means for the future, because thanks to this find, the focus has once again formed for TRINIL. And I think in general, Asia, like Mark has just explained to us, and Indonesia in particular, the Philippines, those are really the exciting places for paleoanthropology. And I think we will see a lot of surprises from this region turn up in the coming years. So I'm very excited to be working here. I'm not the first one by far, because fossils have been found on Java for a very long time. One of the first fossil finders was an Indonesian, Raden Saleh, and a little bit later, Franz Jungmann, he was a German, who also was working on Java. These fossils are also in Leiden and Naturalis, so there's a whole collection from a long time. Eugène Dubois has become, I think, one of the most famous fossil finders on Java, because he was the one who, at this site, TRINIL, found the skull cap, the femur, the molar. And a later expedition that was done by the Germans, and notably by a German woman, Frau Elinora Selenka, she did a great excavation at the same spot and also on the other bank of the river, but unfortunately she didn't find any Homo erectus material. These are the very famous fossils. But it's not only TRINIL, because afterwards fossils were found as well in Sangiran. Kudumbugus was actually the very first one found by Dubois, but also younger Homo erectus from Gangwon. And of course, the famous Homo erectus skull from Mojokerto. So, just to give you a taste, I think most of you will know this very well. If you step back, further back in time, to the very first hominins, then we are talking about 4.5 million years ago, Ardipithecus, followed by the Australopithecines about 3.5-4 million years ago. And then later, when we go upwards in time, here we find early Homo and what later became Homo erectus. So this is the moment very well described by David this morning, where Homo erectus went out of Africa. This is also just to give you a taste of what they look like, maybe. And here is our friend Homo erectus. So what was so special about what Eugène Dubois did, not only was he totally obsessed with finding what then was called the missing link between apes and between humans, but also he was maybe the very first person, not only the father of paleoanthropology, but also the father of paleoecology. Because he appreciated that in order to understand this hominin, you would have to understand its environment and the other animals and plants that it was living with. So Eugène Dubois collected huge number of fossils, and not only of these very very big elephants and buffets, but also tiny bird bones, tiny fish bones, and all the shells that were found. And normally in paleontological excavations and also in archaeological excavations, you know, anything aquatic is more or less regarded as not so very important as the bigger vertebrate land mammals. But he collected everything, and this has been really the strength of his Dubois collection. This is a stratigraphy. As you can see, this is the river water level during the dry season, and this is the river water level during the wet season. I will show some photos later on and give you a little bit of idea. This is a stack of about 12 meters above this bone-bearing bed. And here is the femur, the skull cap, and the teeth. It's really surprising that from the beginning there was a lot of discussion whether these remains were from one individual, but also if they were remains of one species. And even as recently as early last year, there was a paper published suggesting that, okay, yes, this skull cap belonged to Homo erectus, but this femur was more than human sapiens. Well, it's hard to imagine how then it came up in one layer, but it shows that this is still a place that has a lot of, you know, critical followers and people who tend to be very careful about trusting a collection that is so old and made so long ago, and how can we know for sure that things were found where they said they were found. So I think it's really important that we keep on working on this site, because this is the type specimen of Homo erectus. These are really, really very important fossils, and it's not good if questions remain about the taxonomy of these fossils. So now, to go back to the shell, what happened in the spring of 2007? I was visited by a colleague from Australia, Stephen Munro. He was on his way to Ethiopia, to Addis Ababa, to work on shells from the hominin sites in the Afar Basin. And he made a stop over in Amsterdam. He stayed for a few days with us. We started talking about shells, and then I remembered that I had seen a lot of shells in the Dubois collection as well. So I suggested, well, maybe you should go and have a look at them, which he did, and he had not a lot of time, so instead of, you know, carefully studying them while in Leiden, he decided to make photos of all the shells. And this is one of the photos that he made, and he made photos of all the hundreds of shells similar like these. But when he came back to Australia after his fieldwork in the Afar, and he started looking at those photos, he said, well, there's one that has a little bit of a strange pattern on it. Do you have any idea what it can be? We looked at it and we had no idea. And then we asked around biologists, do you have any idea? No, nobody knew what it could be. Archaeologists also said, well, yeah, difficult, what should we say? So at first we left it, because these are the kinds of things that, well, it's so hard to know what has been going on with shells that have been excavated more than 100 years ago. They have been sitting in collection all that time. What has happened to them in the meanwhile, we simply don't know. But we thought that it was nevertheless very valuable to just study them and see what a detailed analysis could tell us. What we did was then enlist the help of Francesco Derico. He's a person here in the middle. And this is Wim Lusterhauer. I was at that time working at the VU. And he was the one who was specializing in working on studying art and whether there were any fakes in art. So he was used to looking really critical at modified artifacts and things that have been done by people to things in order to try to, you know, fix something. And according to Wim, he said, it looks really old and it looks really like it was something original. This was the moment when we put the shell under this microscope, and this is a very special infinite focus microscope that allows you to really look into the grooves that were made. And what you can see then, because these are very nice photos, what you can see is that they look not like something that is made very recently, but they look very weathered. There's a layer that has been lost. And in order to compare these grooves in our shell, we made experimental grooves in similar shells. And we did that with different tools in order to have some kind of comparison. And for instance, this is the original. And this was an experimental groove made with a stone tool. This one was made with a metal scalpel. And this one was made with a sharp tooth. Here you can see the same images, but at a higher magnification. And what we can then see is that you see a big difference between this one and between the fresh ones. And you can see that this looks really weathered and softened at the level of almost the individual aragonite crystals. And also what we could see from this is that the groove made with the sharp tooth looks most in morphology like the groove in our fossil shell. This is another image that really shows very well that you can follow the groove up till a certain moment, but then it is lost due to the weathering phenomenon. So the conclusions of this study were, okay, the engraved lines are really old. They were made before the weathering of the shell, and we couldn't identify any animal that could have made them. So it looked like they were made by humans, and also because of this very regular zigzag pattern. And we concluded that they must have been made with a sharp object, probably a tooth, for instance a sharp tooth. And also it's very important to realize that originally they must have been white lines on a black or brownish background, because these shells are freshwater shells and they have a kind of black-brown covering when they are fresh. Of course the shell, like you see now, is white, it's all weathered, and the lines are hardly visible. But we think that this is what it must have looked like originally. Maybe it was, the pattern was even bigger than this, but part of it may have gone lost completely. And of course, when we realized that the shell was something special, we decided to take a closer look at all the shells. And it turned out there were more than 100 of those very similar Cernodon shells in the collection. And what was really striking, and that is something that I can recall from seeing them for the first time, is that they were like coming from a factory. They were like identical, all big, all the same, very boring really, but very special, because normally if you look at an assemblage that is coming from a natural environment, you would have smaller and bigger shells, because you have young ones, of course, and you have old ones, and then you have these are examples of other collections made on Java, of shells from a similar genus, also Pseudodon. You can see there's small ones, there's big ones. And in the case of TRINIL, we only find big ones, and this is the only one that is a little bit smaller. So there were no juveniles at all. And something else that was very peculiar, and that is something that you start to notice when you handle all the shells and you measure them. Many of them had a strange hole like this. And when we started documenting the holes and the place where the holes were, we noticed that it was all in this similar spot. And This is what they look like, more or less. They are variable in size, but they look a bit ragged. They are not like holes made by animals. There are some carnivorous snails that are very well known for making holes in shells, but those are very nice, rounded, drilled ones. And this is completely different. So we experimentally made a hole to see how it could be explained. Because we noticed that, okay, Homo erectus obviously collected large shells, preferentially, because there was no indication of any small ones, and made holes in them. But why would you do it, and how would you have done that? And we decided that in order to really find out and understand, we needed to do some experimental archaeology and do the experiments on living shells, because that was what Homo erectus probably had been doing as well. These are the fossil ones, some examples of holes. And this is our experiment with shells that, or mollusks, I have to say now, because they are living animals. They were collected in rivers in the south of France, and one comes from Corsica. And they are very comparable to the now extinct one from Java. They have quite a thick shell, and they have a similar leathery covering as those pterodons from TRINIL. So they are really, really comparable. What we used for our experiment was a shark tooth, because there are shark teeth at TRINIL. And as you can see, these are the fossil teeth from TRINIL. They are really very suitable to make holes, because they are very hard, they are pointy, they are nice to handle. And when we did our experiments, at first I thought it would be easy to just, you know, punch through, but that was simply impossible. You would immediately destroy your sharp tooth, because those shells are really thick and tough. There's a lot of organic material when they are still alive in the carbonate, and it's not easy to get through. But when you make a drilling motion, you do get through very easily. And also what we noticed when we made this hole at this particular location, that is where the muscle that the animal uses to keep the shell valves closed is located. So when you make the hole there, you hit the muscle, you damage the muscle, and the animal lets go. And then it's really easy to fold the shell open and eat the contents. So that was probably quite an elegant way of opening the shells and consuming the animal. So we looked further, and we looked even better at the shells, and then we noticed that there was one that had also a little bit of a strange, what looked like a modification. And this, when you remove the outer white layer, what you have here is the nacre, and that is a very hard element of the shell. And essentially what this is a shell knife, and it's a very great tool, in fact. And again, with the help of Francesco, we've been able to show that this is really an unambiguous tool. And the funny thing is that a few years before we published, cut marks had been found on bones from Java, fossil bones. And the people who studied them, they noticed that the groove morphology, so how the cut marks look like, it suggested that they were made by shells, by shell tools. At that moment, nobody had any idea what kind of shells they could be. And so this was kind of a theoretical inferral that there must have been shell tools. So we were happy that indeed we could confirm that Homo erectus on Java used shell tools. And of course then it became more and more important to be able to assign a good date to these shells, because it was really very strange to find shell tools, and especially to find this engraving on a shell. Because this engraving looks like something that could have been made by you and me, something that looks like a geometric drawing almost. How old would it have been? TRINIL originally has been assigned a range of dates, some as young as half a million years old, but others up till a million or maybe even older than that. So finding a geometric pattern made by hominins of a million year old, that's really very uncomfortable. That would have been quite terrible. And we realized that we need to be able to say something more about the age of these shells. And we were very fortunate that many of those shells, they are still, the two valves are still together, suggesting that they haven't been transported very far. But also, they were filled with sediments. And you can see that some of them are filled with quite small grain size sediment, and others with more coarse material. But the very good thing is that there were some components in the infill that were really very good for dating. And it means that we could apply two dating methods, one to establish a minimum age and one to establish a maximum age. This is the engraved shell that you can see here. This is the infill. I can still remember the moment when Frank was very, very carefully preparing to take this part out, because of course we were very worried that we would damage the shell. We had to proceed very carefully, but we managed to take out this piece of the original infill and then use luminescence dating on the feldspars to establish a minimum age of about 430,000 years. So that was quite young, but of course this was minimum age. And we needed to find the other range spectrum. And what was also in the infill of these shells is hornblende. That's a volcanic mineral. Of course, Java is full of volcanoes. Volcanoes blow out a lot of volcanic material all the time. And we have been able to date different populations of hornblende in these shells. And the youngest population gave us a maximum age of these shells of about half a million years ago. But you can see that the error is considerable. But still, it's quite close together. And together, it gave us a good and much better handle on the age of the site of TRINIL. And it shows that it must have been something in the range of about 640,000 till 380,000, which at least puts us not too far away from other engraved material from the archaeological record. It depends also on what you accept as engraved material. There are some things that you could put in between, from Wiltingsleben, for instance. So that is a bit of a discussion still. But okay, by far you can see that this was an engraving made by a totally different hominin species, not Homo sapiens, not Homo neanderthalensis, but Homo erectus, and also that it is much older than the so far oldest engravings. So this was really, really a spectacular finding, that half a million years ago on Java, Homo erectus ate freshwater shellfish. Well, that doesn't surprise me. Animals do that too. They modified shells into tools, which is nice, because one of the puzzling things about Java is that so far stone tools, which you find almost everywhere in the world on Java, hardly. So maybe there was a shell culture instead of a stone culture. And of course we had this geometric pattern on the shells. And of course a lot of questions came up, especially after publishing. People asked, so is this the oldest art? And what does it say about Homo erectus intelligence? And will there be more things that we could find once we know that something like this may be out there? And I think these are all very difficult questions to answer, and I think we need to be first answering some more basic things. Well, is it art? I don't know. Maybe the pattern is just being beautiful. We still like it. I'm always surprised how many people wear zigzag patterns. But of course, it is very important to refine the age of TRINIL, not only because it's always nice to know an age as exact as we can have it, but also because it is very important for the bigger biogeographical picture. Here is a very recent sea level curve of Asia. This comes from based on monsoonal records from China. And this is a sea level curve. You can see this is a low stand and this is a high stand. This is the age range of TRINIL. And what we very much like to know, of course, is does TRINIL, is it during a sea level low stand that this site was dated, or is it during sea level high stand? Because during a sea level high stand, the island of Java is isolated from the Asian mainland, whereas when sea levels are low, it's connected, and then all kinds of dispersals and movements are possible. So it's important to know. And of course, John will tell me that it's not needed, he knows already. It's a very open environment, so it's probably during a glacial period. But then again, it is which one? It could be this one, it could be this one. And that's why we now are trying to refine the dating. And also, of course, now we did the dating on a shell. And this being an old collection, we don't know exactly where in the stratigraphy this shell is coming from. We don't know exactly how far or how close it was to the actual bones, and especially to the Homo erectus bones. We assume it's all the same level, but this is something that we would like to confirm for sure. One of the things that we can do, that we are in the process of doing now, is using, similar as the shells, use infills of bones to do the dating. And here you can see a cranium of a serpent that has, like here, small pumice, and more pumices like this. Pumice is volcanic material, and you can even see the hornblende crystals sitting in this pumice. So this would be ideal material for further dating. And other bones, as you can see here, they have an infill of very nice, beautiful, clean calcite. And this is typically something that you can use for uranium and thorium dating. With a bit of luck, we are in the right age range. So this is now ongoing work. But of course, for the real dating, you need to go and look in more detail. And another approach that we chose, working with museum material, is a look at the isotopic ratios of herbivores. I think most of you will be familiar with the idea that you can have either grazers in a certain environment, open environment, grazers on grass that have a certain isotopic, carbon isotopic signal that's called C4, the C4 pathway that the plants use. And you have C3 plants that you could say are more like forests and woodlands. So if you measure the carbon isotope ratio of your herbivores, you have an idea if there's a lot of grass in your environment or if there's a lot of forest in your environment. And what we did is use different herbivores, bovids and cervids, and for good measure we also use some pigs that are of course omnivores. And what you can see here is, I won't go into all the details, but TRINIL is firmly in the C4 range, indicating grazing on grass. So indeed it looks like TRINIL was a glacial site. And this means that at the time of TRINIL, it was most likely connected to other islands and to the Asian mainland. But of course, this is just loose material from old collections. If you really want to know, you have to go back to the original site. And we are really very happy and fortunate that the Indonesians are very enthusiastic about the work, and they are very happy with the idea that the earliest signs of creativity in humans or hominids come from Indonesia. It's a huge matter of a source of pride. So we've been invited to come to Indonesia and to go back to TRINIL to re-excavate. Well, this is not an easy matter, of course. This is something that you have to start a complete new collaboration, start a new project. So last year we negotiated and signed a memorandum of understanding to collaborate, and this year we can, for the first time, go back to TRINIL. That's this spot is where everything comes from. This is the original site from Eugène Dubois. This is the Solo River. This is the stream direction. So we will go back, and I'm going to fly there later this month, the 22nd, and our objective now for the first year is to really establish a geological framework and take samples for dating, and then not only this bone bearing layer, but also the layers on top of it and the layers below, so that we build a robust chronology. That is our objective. Well, this is just to give you some more photos of the site as it is now. This is the TRINIL Museum, very charming. This is, you can still see actually the remnants of the old excavations. And what you can also see, and that's also lucky, is that this is still land that is farmed and that is, well, parked, it's more or less wild. This means that it will be fairly easy to convince the landowner to have us work there and to do the re-excavation here, to try and find the best spots if we want to go back in later years to carry out further work. What we aim to do is also go a bit downstream and go a bit upstream. And basically when you go downstream, you go upwards in time, and when you go upstream, you go backwards in time. So we will also explore for other outcrops. This is what the place looks like now, and you can see it has a lot of vegetation. I'm afraid we'll have to remove all of that, so that will be quite a challenge to find a place where we can make a nice clean section. But you can see that all the old stuff is still there. Of course, this is not something that we will be doing alone. As Leiden University, I'm very happy that there will be colleagues also from United States, Frank Huffman, who has been working together with John and with Paul Albers on trying to understand the excavations made by Dubois and by Selenka. What exactly have they been doing, when, where? How do the two excavations link? How can we interpret the collections? And how can we go about finding the best spots if we want to do a new excavation? And our master student, Gerrit Aling, he has made a kind of an assessment of the potential where other good places would be to go and look for new fossils. Because ideally, of course, we would like to find as good a spot as Eugène Dubois found, and ideally we would want to find more hominid fossils, but also maybe artifacts or whatever remains that we can find. And this would be one of the places that we could scout for further outcrops. This is TRINIL last year during the high water level, and I hope by the time we will be going now, it will be nice low water level for us to work. Thank you very much.